Para México, octubre es un mes lleno de significados. Dos eventos han marcado al país de una manera muy poderosa. Por un lado, los Juegos Olímpicos. Y por otro, la masacre de un número aún desconocido de estudiantes. Por ello, este será un observatorio especialmente particular, el cual queremos dedicar a los hombres y mujeres libres de esa generación. Los Juegos Olímpicos de 1968 en la Ciudad de México fueron los Juegos Olímpicos con mayor carga política desde los Juegos de 1936 en Berlín. 10 días antes de la inauguración de las Olimpiadas, el gobierno mexicano disparó contra estudiantes desarmados para silenciar las demandas de aquellos jóvenes que exigían democracia. Durante los Juegos, en la competencia de los 200 metros planos masculinos, los estadounidenses Tommy Smith y John Carlos ganaron medalla de oro y bronce, respectivamente. Durante la ceremonia de premiación, los dos recibieron sus respectivos premios de una forma nunca vista en estas ceremonias. Iban descalzos, cada uno con la cabeza inclinada y un guante negro cubriendo a cada uno un puño levantado durante el himno de los Estados Unidos. Ese momento se congeló en el tiempo y será por siempre recordado como un poderoso y noble gesto de protesta. John Carlos y Tommy Smith describieron ese momento como un homenaje a su herencia afroamericana y una protesta por las condiciones de vida de las minorías en los Estados Unidos. Los funcionarios del Comité Olímpico Internacional y del Comité Olímpico de los Estados Unidos consideraron que la exhibición era contraria a los ideales de los Juegos y Smith y Carlos fueron expulsados de la Villa Olímpica y mandados a casa. Es importante mencionar que Peter Norman, de Australia, quien ganó la medalla de plata en esa misma carrera, portaba en el podio de los ganadores una insignia del Proyecto Olímpico para los Derechos Humanos como símbolo de apoyo a Tommy Smith y John Carlos. También nos acompaña hoy, en este programa, Wyomia Tyus. Ella es velocista, aquella velocista que obtuvo el récord mundial en la carrera de 100 metros en 1964, 1965, 1968 y 1972. Y fue la primera atleta, hombre o mujer, en ganar la medalla de oro olímpica 2 veces consecutivas en ese evento. Aquí, en México 68, a pesar de no ser la favorita de los expertos de la época, defendió su título de 100 metros ganando en un tiempo récord y estableciendo una nueva marca mundial de 11.08 segundos. Ganaría posteriormente su tercer oro olímpico como ancla del equipo de relevos de 4 por 100 metros y Wyomia participaría después, tiempo después, en competencias de atletismo profesional y finalmente cerraría su carrera como comentarista de deportes en la televisión. Chris Kluwe fue jugador profesional de fútbol americano y hoy es escritor. Él asistió a la Universidad de California en Los Ángeles, donde jugó fútbol americano universitario para los Bruins. Jugó profesionalmente en la National Football League para los Seattle Seahawks, Minnesota Vikings y Oakland Raiders. Él, expateador, Chris Kluwe, ya que fue separado sin ceremonia de los Minnesota Vikings, y sería posteriormente proscrito en toda la NFL. Sin embargo, su despido hoy, más que nunca, cobra una gran relevancia. Kluwe y muchas personas en todo el mundo creen que su despido se debió a su apoyo abierto a los derechos de la comunidad LGBT. Kenneth Shropshire. Él es Adidas Distinguished Professor del Global Sport CEO y del Global Sport en la Universidad Estatal de Arizona. Shropshire es licenciado en Economía por la Universidad de Stanford y licenciado en Derecho por la Universidad de Columbia. También es miembro del Colegio de Abogados del Estado de California. Como líder de la industria del deporte, él ha presidido la Asociación de Abogados Deportivos en Estados Unidos, la cual es la organización de este tipo más grande del mundo. Hoy, para hablar de esta historia que empezó aquí en el Estadio Olímpico de Ciudad Universitaria hace ya 50 años, están con nosotros todos ellos, John Carlos, Wyomia Tyus, Chris Kluwe y Kenneth Shropshire.
Wyomia, John, Kenneth, Chris, thank you for being here in this program tonight. And it's a real pleasure to have you here. And probably this is a question a lot of people ask you, but tell us, one, when and why did you decide to stand for yourselves and for the rights of others? Wyomia.
Well, for me, I always stood for myself and others, I think starting as a young child. I grew up with three older brothers, and I grew up fighting for equal playing field with them. And then people saying to me, oh, girls are not to play with boys, and girls are not to be good. You just go out and play and don't sweat. And that was not my makeup. So I started then fighting for those rights that I wanted. And as I got older, I realized everybody has to fight for their rights. Otherwise, they get taken from you in some way, or fashion, or form. By coming to 68 for the Olympics and before the Olympics and all the things that were happening in not just America, but all over the world, all the unjust things that were happening to people and not having their human rights, I started getting more involved. And also the coach at Tennessee State at Temple would always say to us when we would go on trips that, you know, you could go and win all these medals and you come back and nobody will ever recognize you or all that one black woman and all of those things. So you have to be able to stand up for yourself and stand up for what you believe in and make sure that you get an education, because with the education, no one can take that from you. And that sports is just a vehicle that will open the door for you. Education will keep the door wide open. And I look at it sometimes as he had a platform too for us that, you know, you're going to be able to speak to a lot of people and you should be able to have a conversation and say the things that bothers you or bothers the world or you see bothering the world. And then in 68, when they came with the boycott and the Project for Human Rights, that was just automatic for me.
This is absolutely I didn't know how I would react. And as soon as we walked in, I started having chill bumps and I couldn't believe it. But it is definitely, I feel very grateful and thankful for Mexico City and for the people that made it possible for me to even be here today. This is my first time I ever set and foot on this track, and I still remember it as it was then, and it is something that will always be very close to my heart. And again, thanks to everybody for coming out and being a part of this, another history-making event, and this time, a history-making event not just for all people. So, you know, so now people are more aware of what's going on in the world and what we need to do to change a lot of things in this world. And all of you are part of that and can make more history by writing about it and talking about it and encouraging people to stand up for human rights.
I've always believed in people having human rights. A lot of that was taken from me from in the 60s, growing up in the South in Georgia, that you would go and there's colors here, whites here. You know, you couldn't use certain bathrooms, couldn't drink from certain fountains. So all these things, I mean, I've been fighting for that for years, and this was just something to come up to where it could lead to bigger things, and I was helping more people. More people will hear me. I had a platform, and I think if you have a platform and you believe in yourself and believe in your cause that much, you should speak from that platform and people could hear what I had to say. A lot of times, I mean, in the 60s, in 1968, they weren't interviewing and talking to women about human rights. They were talking to us or how we felt about that. But there were a lot of us that were, and I was just one of the few. But there were a lot of other athletes that were doing that. And what we need, not only since the 60s, we need in this day and time, that more people speaking up, and not just the women, we need other people speaking up along with the women.
That's true, and it's been a long road.
Yes.
What about you, John?
Well, you know, I've been a civil rights activist from the time I was a little kid. I guess it started when I realized there was bullies in the world. And a lot of people wouldn't stand up to the bullies. They kind of shied away from them. And I was the one that used to like to get in the bully's face, say, you want to bully somebody, don't pick on them, they can't defend themselves, pick on me. But it grew from that in terms of, who the ultimate bully was. You know, it grew from a kid in school being a bully. Then I began to realize that it was big business that was the bully. It was the Board of Education was the bully. The government was the bully. In terms of social issues where it wasn't a level playing field. Everyone didn't have medical care. Everyone didn't have fair housing or fair employment. Everyone didn't have food in their fridge. Whether you was here not 50 years ago, you're definitely a part of history today by being here to celebrate this with us today on a serious note. Everything we did was for this moment, to come back to think that people will remember us for our deeds 50 years ago as youngsters. There's a lot of things we could have did. Maybe there's a lot of things we want to do. But God chose us to be here at October of 1968, and we'll be forever in gratitude for God and Mexico City. It was the greatest thing that I got out of this was the medal, but the greatest thing above that is that I got a lifelong friend. This girl here has been my buddy forever. And not just to say that she's been my buddy, but in the most crucial time when people was pointing and saying negative things or bad things to our teammates to try and discourage them about even being associated with us, this young lady here stepped up to the plate and said, regardless of what you're talking about, I know them personally, I respect them, I love them, and not only that, I want to donate my medals that I win, I want to put my medals up for what they stand for. That took a lot of courage. Most athletes, when they brought cameras out like that, like you guys have cameras, and I'm standing here, most of them would have did like this. Why? For fear of reprisal. They would fear that they would be in a picture with me because what they did to me, they would fear that it might do it to them. But Ty said, I'm not concerned about none of that.
Chris.
For me, I guess I grew up having a very strong sense, I like John, of right and wrong and fairness, in that, you know, if I had something, you know, other people should have that thing. If other people have something, then I should be able to have that thing. And I don't know that I was really, like, widespread socially active growing up. It was more my friends, my family members, like, you know, they definitely knew that I wanted things to be fair and equal. And it wasn't until when I was in the NFL when someone asked me, they said, hey, you know, we have this issue coming up. There's LGBTQ people being persecuted. Can you help defend against this? And it occurred to me, I have the platform. I'm in a position to do something about this. Yeah, I will help you because I can, and I would want someone to do the same for me. So I think a lot of it was just growing up and learning it, and also learning about my own privilege and the fact that, you know, as someone who is white, like I do have advantages that other people aren't afforded. And as an athlete, I want to beat you knowing we're on a level playing field. Like, I want to know that my best was better than your best, not that you were left behind and then I got a, you know, 50-yard head start and a 100-yard dash. Like, that's not fair. So it's really about making sure everyone has the same chances, the same opportunities, and then it's up to you what you do with them. But we're not there yet, and it's going to take a lot of hard work to get there.
Kenneth, from the university, what are you doing? I mean, from a more intellectual point of view, what's going on? I mean, what happened then, and what's happening now?
Well, I think that's the important issue, is to understand the past so that we can do even better in this period and in the future. So a lot of what we're doing, the idea of the Global Sport Institute supporting programs like this, is to make sure people understand what happened and understand what's happening today. And how can we keep moving the needle forward instead of sliding backwards? You know, in the States, there was a sense of complacency when we had a black president, that all of a sudden everything was okay. Well, as we see now that we have a different president, things are not okay. So you know, when kids talk about you got to stay woke, it's an idea of being focused on the issue constantly. And as everybody said, understanding that it's all our responsibility, that we all want this to be a better world. And if we don't do this together, there's a very negative place we can fall back into.
There's a long line story here, starting in 68 and to the present. But we're going to have a very small cut, and we'll be back in a second.
How many guys right now want to put some money on the ground? My New York thing is coming out now. How many guys out here want to drop, run 220 meters, drop $220 on the ground and let's see who's the best man out here today.
This is just reminds me of that great day. Mm-hmm. You know, just standing here and standing in front of the blocks. Can't do the dance anymore. And just shaking out and getting ready, preparing psychologically and everything. And ready.
Here comes the rain.
The rain came, but it waited until I finished, which was great. It had been raining and raining, and then we had two jumps in the race. Margaret Bales from the U.S. and Barbara Farrell from the U.S. Margaret jumped first, and then Barbara jumped second. And for me, it was great because Barbara had an excellent, excellent start. And all my goals throughout my career running against her, can I be within two steps of her when she gets out of the blocks? That way I think I could beat her. And once she had that jump on her, I had an opportunity. My opportunity was right there. I was like, I have very little to worry about now, because they have this, my toughest competition, and I saw it, they have to sit in a box and wait for the gun. And Mexico City, finals on 100 meters was the best start I've ever had in my whole life. And it was the best time to have it. And it had not rained, it rained earlier. And when they jumped, the first jump, it was a little sprinkles. And then Barbara jumped and a little bit more sprinkles. And we were walking back. And I was saying, you guys need to stop because it's going to rain. It's going to rain. We don't want to run in the rain. And it just stopped. And when the gun went off, we ran the whole 100 meters with no rain. Seems like as soon as we crossed the finish, then the sky just kind of opened up. And I know on the victory stand, people always, they have pictures of me standing on the victory stand and I'm doing this. They're thinking I'm crying. It was not that. I was trying to get down in the water.
Okay, I have a question that is maybe a little bit tricky, but I think it's important. In face of the consequences you've suffered for stand up for your rights and the rights of others, do you think it is worth it? What changes with the things you're done?
My fall's worth it. When you sit back, you say, is it worth it? You think that Harriet Tubman did what she did? The question is, was it worth what she did? She saved a tremendous amount of people from slavery and bondage. You know, you have someone that might be in bondage on a physical side with chains and shackles around their necks and legs. But then in modern day, there's a thing called slavery, and it's called mental slavery. So when you become that beacon by saying, I choose to speak out against the atrocities of society, a demonstration or a statement is made not just for the local area, but it's made as a beacon for society as a whole around the world. Because if you sit back and think about it, all of us around the world have these same ills that we are dealing with, but they just haven't seen anyone deal with it until you have an opportunity to be at the Olympic Games at the highest level and present your case to the world.
Chris?
Yeah, I would say it's totally worth it. I mean, because at the end of the day, sports, you know, we all love sports. We all put a lot of time and effort into sports, but they're children's games. And the society we live in, that's what's important. How we treat people as human beings, that's what's important. And so to have even one person come up and say to you, hey, when I saw you speak out, when I saw you stand up, that gave me the courage to right. do the same, like that makes everything worth it, because you've made one person's life better. And then hopefully they'll make someone else's life better. And then it just keeps going and going and going. So I would say to anyone out there, yeah, it's always worth it. I mean, it might suck in the short term, but you're helping to make the world a better place.
Probably.
Well, I think too, I'm along the same lines they are. I mean, you have a cause, you know what you believe in, you understand what right and wrong, and you see there are people that are being mistreated and not treated fairly.
you're so easy not to say anything. The hardest thing for most for people to do is to stand up and be counted, so to speak. I think we all need to do that, and that's what makes a better world. I mean, there are people that are very comfortable in where they are in life and how they are living, so they don't want to disturb that. But you know, you have to have, to me, there has to be some disturbance in order to get something going, to make something great happen. And I think by 68, what Carlos and Tommy did on the victory stand, that disturbed a lot of people, and it made a lot of people uncomfortable, but it also made a lot of people start to talk about what the issues they are. The issues are being human rights, and how we, and what we, what he, what they did, and what other people have done, and what other people have come and said and spoken out. I know with Chris, by him, he being a white person and saying the things that he says, it makes other people feel comfortable. It's not just always, it's the blacks that are saying this, the blacks are saying that. So it's okay to be uncomfortable. I think it makes a better world for you to be uncomfortable. It makes you start to think and feel, you know, say maybe right. I need to look at this a little bit different. Or, you know, if your little world get tweaked a little bit, that makes you look at the world a lot different and people a lot different.
Definitely, and we need these voices from then and from now and from the future.
And getting back to the uncomfortable part, it's part of it's also, yeah, you might feel a little uncomfortable, but try to imagine the person who's being oppressed, who's being kept down. How uncomfortable do they feel? Like you're feeling the barest minimum of what they're having to go through. So maybe try to make their lives a little better. You won't feel so uncomfortable. So
let me add to what Chris is saying. You know, when you sit back and you think about, you know, it's a cause for minority people. Poor white people, we're the ones that's being oppressed. So when you sit back and you think about a white individual that's got his life made, everything is set for him, and then he chooses to say, I want to take a different path. I don't want to go and be those that everything is laid out for me. I want to help those that's less fortunate. Now let me give you an example. There was a guy in America named Frederick Douglass, and everyone knows the history of Frederick Douglass, but at the same time, Frederick Douglass had a cohort, was a blonde-haired, blue-eyed individual by the name of John Brown. Now, they were in the abolitionist movement together. Why is it that you know about Frederick Douglass so strongly and you know very little or nothing about John Brown? Is it merely because he's white? Well, here you go, 50 years ago here in Mexico City, it was two black individuals that had a blonde-haired, blue-eyed individual in the name of Peter Norman of Australia that stood with us, stood for equality, stood for fair play, justice, the whole nine yards. But they whitewashed him out of the picture as well for 45 years. You know, they cut him out of the picture. They didn't acknowledge that he was there. And it leads me to believe that maybe they don't want young white kids to grow up with the thought that you could be a liberal person and you could be an honest person and be concerned about equality and be concerned about human rights. So, you know, for Chris to do what he's doing, I commend him and I commend all of the football players once again that came out and supported Mr. Kaepernick, that took a knee or put his hand on his shoulder. The same way they whitewashed those individuals out, they did the same thing to the football players. They would like to do that to Chris. It's the voices of you that need to get out there and make them understand we will not let you forget or paint part of the picture. If you're gonna do it, you're gonna put the whole picture out there. We don't want you to think that when we say white folks are bad people, not all white folks are bad people, but those that might be in the power, the decision makers, the brokers, those are the ones that are the suppressors. And this is towards them to say, hey, we have some good white guys that understand what the game is and are willing to sacrifice as much as I am willing to sacrifice. So let's put it out there where it is.
It is, definitely. And if you have to leave a message for the Mexican youth today, what it would be?
Well, my message to them would be to follow your dreams. Everyone should have a dream. If you don't have a dream, you need to create a dream and have a goal in life that you want to set. And also realize that it's not the brokers here on earth that's going to determine the outcome. It's the ultimate power that's going to determine the outcome, because he's the one that gave you the fluorescent mind to have this vision, this dream. So my attitude for them is to shoot for the stars. Don't let anyone get in your way and deter you from where you want to go, particularly if you know you're going in the right direction.
Wyomia.
Well, to me, I think my message would be that, you know, you have to always be prepared because you never know what your future is going to be. And being prepared is being educated, whether you go to college or not, but being educated on the issues and the things that are happening around you in your country, in your community, and also that you have to look at people and you have to kind of, you can't really put yourself in their shoes, but you have to be able to say, hey, I can see where they're coming from. I see this is not right. And that, you know, you have to fight for what you want. And not just young people. One thing, too, I have to touch on is that women, they don't, I mean, I grew up when women were not encouraged to do a whole lot of things, and especially being involved in sports, but also being involved in movements and all of that. But you have to be, in order to make a change, you have to be, and in order for change to come, you have to have all people involved. You know, one, two, three, four people saying and doing and all that is, you have to have everybody involved. The numbers are better. If you're in a higher number, you get things changed. You think about the 60s when they started the movements of the 60s. You know, it started out small, then it started to grow. And as it grew, then more people learned a lot more about it. And I will always say that with the women that never got talked about, and we are talking about them now, it's a long time coming, but that's what we need. We need people to be involved. They need to be able to stand up, young people, and speak out for what they want and believe in. No matter you're male or female.
Right, that's true. Chris.
I would first and foremost like to apologize for our current president and administration.
Apologies accepted.
Yeah, I think they represent the worst of what America has to offer. And I think that we all need to be fighting against that. And as young people, understand that change doesn't happen quickly, doesn't happen easily, but if you keep at it, then eventually things do change. So, you know, don't, like John said, don't be afraid to chase your dreams. Don't be afraid to go as far as you think you can go. Don't be afraid to push past what you think you can do and go even farther. But also understand that changing things is a long process, and you have to be committed to it. You have to keep working at it. And even if you suffer a setback, like we've suffered right now with Trump in office, you still have to keep pushing. You still have to keep trying to make things better.
Definitely. Kenneth.
I would say dream big, dream with your eyes open, lift others along the way, and don't look for anything in return.
Well, that's incredible. Thank you all for being here. In this setting, the stadium where you won your medals,
yes.
It was
great.
A great moment in history, and for Mexico, it was a great time there. We're going to talk in the beginning of this program about Mexico also, what was happening there. Okay. And well, thank you all for being here, and I hope you enjoy your stay in Mexico.
Let me just say, that all the people of Mexico, I just want them to realize, you know, they hold Tommy Smith, Peter Norman, and John Carlos like we on some sort of plateau. We're not on a plateau in terms of us being a separatist from the reality of the Olympic Games. We are one with Mexico City. This is a history that we share together. Understand what we did in Mexico City by this particular demonstration, or all the black athletes, not just here from the United States, but from around the world that came together for these games. We realized that Mexico City is the pivotal stone of what took place in history 50 years ago. You can never mention John Carlos and not mention Mexico City, or you can never mention Mexico City and not mention John Carlos. We are one for eternity.
Thank you very much.
And listen, I will give y'all the last official Carlos stop.
We start
back here.
No, you don't even know where to start, so you don't know nothing about this.
We started up there.
Yeah,
right here, behind the line.
Yeah.
I got down.
But you're in the wrong, facing the wrong way.
We're going that way.
Not for the 100.
Oh, you
I'm going that way.
Yeah, you was going down the line, right.